Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for joining us wherever you are in the auditorium or wherever you are in the world. Here we are at the Just 2020 World Indoor Bowls Championships live here at Potter's Resort. And coming up for you this morning is one of the games in the Overseas Round Robin Playoffs, Dan LeMessurier versus Ken Chan. Great bowls lineup all day for you today, folks, so stay with us. Straight after this game, we'll have another of the overseas games. Richard Corrie plays against Jack Breen. Then at 2 o'clock, one of our first round games. Seeded number 9, Jamie Chesney takes the rink against Scotland's Chris Carswell. And following that, another one of the overseas round robin games. Dan LeMessurier plays against Boaz Marcus. The match officials for this game, the marker is Dan Blewett and the umpire is the lovely Bernie Hill. And I'd like to hand over now, greenside, to the lovely Johnny Laff to introduce our players.
Oh, thank you, Janice. Well, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the Just World Indoor Bowls Championships here at Potter's Resort. Now, these players have travelled a long, long way to be here, so please make them feel very, very welcome. And flying in from Hong Kong with national titles, let's welcome in Ken Chan.
How you get so much favor on your side? Accept the measure, Lord and Savior, I replied. That's your love, that neighbor, not the bad. I'm a rat, that's on God. His light shining brightest.
And ladies and gentlemen, Ken's opponent from USA with several titles to his name, please welcome Dan LeMessurier.
I get no
over to your commentary team of Janice Gower and Dean McQuilly.
Well, thank you very much, Johnny. And interesting game on the cards this morning, America versus Hong Kong. And as you mentioned, delighted to be joined in the commentary box by an Australian qualifier, Dale McWinney. Welcome to the commentary box here, Dale.
Thank you very much. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. Look forward to commentating my first World Bowls Tour game.
Yeah, we're delighted to have you join us for a couple of the games today.
Meters.
It's fantastic that we now get the streaming out to everyone. Lots of viewers in the highlights yesterday of the two pairs games in the open pairs in the main events were fantastic viewing figures. Don't forget, we're live for you on worldbowlstour.tv for all your news and results. And also on Twitter, WBT_TV, and on Facebook, wherever you're joining us from. If you've got any questions, if you want to put any questions to Dale, I'm sure we can put him on the spot. Do put it through to our production team and we'll get those answered for you. Interesting format this, Dale. They're playing in a round robin, so that means every player in the group plays each other to go through to the main singles draw.
Yeah, so only taking one from the section, I believe, and it seems pretty close at the moment from what I've seen. Dan's only played the one game, maybe because he was in the pairs at the very beginning. I haven't seen anyone win all sets so far, so Dan's game I saw last night, he started off absolutely amazing, so I would say he's going to continue his form here.
Yeah, both of them have put in some time on the rink. They've had plenty of practice time.
Yeah.
Ken's certainly been putting in some hours. Very flamboyant player. Sparkly shoes and all sorts.
His mirror shoes.
Yes, very flamboyant player. And actually, both of them are, really. It's Dan LeMessurier, one of the most consistent qualifiers from the USA.
He's been to almost every event the last few years, from what I've seen.
Yes, you're right. And he also won the Overseas Player of the Year last year at the awards night.
Very nice.
Because he'd qualified in, I think it was 3 out of 4 last year, and they've done very similar again here. And this is another good opening bowl.
Great two starters. From what I've seen, he's been turning up for practice here. Bright and early at 5 a.m. from what I've seen. I've been rocking up at 6 to get a bit of practice in, and he's always beaten me here.
I'm afraid to say that's far too early for me, either 5 or 6.
Yeah, it's required, I think.
Well, I think for the viewers, just to let them know, it's a situation of you book half an hour slots to have a practice. And of course, you can't practice while games are in progress. So really, practice times are at a premium. And you yourself, Dale, you're playing next weekend in the under-25s.
Yes, so playing on the 25th and not a great deal of practice, as I am not here for the whole time between now and then. So that's why I've been turning up early, trying to get as much time as I can on there, trying to learn the green. Very different to home, so
18
doing the very best I can. Give myself the best chance, hopefully.
That green to the back, past your bowl. 8 inches.
Certainly good opening there for Dan.
Bit of holding
pressure
two.
Here. Yeah, a bit of pressure here for Kent.
Wouldn't want to be a way to start the set, dropping that two. You want to get off for winning that first turn, calm some of the nerves of being out there in front of a fairly medium-sized crowd. Medium to small.
Yeah, people will be drifting in from breakfast. We tend to find this that... Got his own bowl away.
Gap perfect. Dan's got a really good shot on here on his back end. Draw for three and a touch of jacks, a bonus. Get the full crown to start the game. See him running down the green.
He's trotting back down. He's been used to playing under the shot clock, and he did say to me before he came into this event he wanted to still be aware of that because you don't want to qualify through this qualifier, then go into the main singles draw, face the shot clock, and forget about that.
Yeah, I've never been under the shot clock, so will that be the case for the under 25 singles?
It's the case for everything apart from the pairs and obviously this overseas playoff where they just play two sets of seven ends. We have no tie break.
Three shots,
it's just purely two sets of seven ends in this game.
Good shots by Dan. Big start.
Set score 3-0, first end.
Oh, great start. Yes, it's... Having watched you play on the portable rink, Dale, I don't think you'll have any problems for pace for the shot clock.
Unless I'm not alert to it at some point that I'm going to have to keep in mind. I have seen a couple of cases where people have lost games from not watching the shot clock, which would be devastating, especially coming all this way as a qualifier and doing something like that would be
27.5 metres.
Devastating.
Yes, I totally agree with you. I think... I believe you're going to join me this afternoon for the Jamie Chesney game, and I think that will be a good one for you to watch, really, to see how to... He's one of the great exponents of the shot clock, is Jamie, so that'll
right.
be a good one to watch.
Don't think I've ever seen Jamie play, so that'll be good. I've noticed in all the roll-ups I've had with Dan, he always seems to throw the quite a long length, but not full length, anywhere from like the 26, 27 metres.
Tends to play bowls to the tee. Of course, the winner of this overseas group's round robin playoff will face Mark Royal in the main draw, and Dan LeMessurier faced Mark Royal at the Scottish International Open back in November. I don't think he wants that game mentioning. It was he didn't play his best, let's put it that way. I'm sure he won't mind me saying that.
Poor guy, a couple of bit of harsh comments from people back home, a bit of criticism of how his game went and shot selection. And you know, coming over here as a qualifier and trying to play against the world's top 16 who are so used to this, in my eyes you have to try and do some different things to measure out, to be more even with them, because you're not going to beat them at their draw game. Their draw game's sensational here, so used to it. And a great shot.
Great effort. Yes, and I think that's why he chose the Walk-On music of I Get Knocked Down But I Get Up Again, which I thought was excellent. He thought
10 inches
he thought it was very
Jack
appropriate
high.
Considering his performance in previous events, but he's played very well. And he's got here. It's like you say, it's tough going out there to play somebody that's a regular on the portable rink. Mm. It is an interesting rink to play on.
Running at about 19, 20 seconds.
Yeah, I think so. I had a practice on it this morning and it was still quite swift. Slowed down a little bit, I think.
Yep.
The early days it was even up to sort of 20, 21 seconds, whereas it slowed down a bit. I think it's a nice pace now out there.
Yeah, yeah. I was out there really early, so yeah, it was the same. It was a bit slower than it had been when I was playing my pairs game on it. Oh, he's added
onto the
some
line.
Weight.
Needs to hang on. Can it hang on?
Doesn't want the jack. Wanted to bowl. He's played it perfect.
Got a nice 1-2 there.
Maybe even his bowl that he hit could have covered a tee,
red.
Possibly. I don't know if I saw that.
You were talking about shot clock. I was just counting then at Ken's delivery. Mm. There is plenty of time. You get 30 seconds in the main event for actually delivering your bowl, and you can take 60-second timeout. So there is plenty of time, but it's like you were mentioning before, sometimes that time can just run away from you and you just tend to forget.
Trying to figure out what shot you want to play, you're in a hard situation during the game or something like that, and totally forget about it.
So Dan's got a good chance here. He's got a toucher in the ditch there. You mentioned that his bowl had gone through. Yeah. Dale, you can see it marked on the back there with a red disc. Chance for count of three here for Dan.
In drift a little bit, he might be fairly close, I would say.
All on his pace now.
May not be the worst shot, depending on what Ken plays. There is a chance he could get both bowls out there, do you think, Janice?
Yeah, I think he might go for it. I've not seen much of Ken playing, so I don't know if he is an aggressive player. I think there's the chance there, and it's hard to just draw to beat those bowls, whereas I think both bowls go.
Yeah, I think I'd be running or even going quick, trying to get both bowls. He doesn't have a major risk on the spot. He's no worse if the jack goes in the ditch. He doesn't stay around.
Gets the percentage bolt. Yep, he's going for it.
Fairly
close.
Area. Oh, he's been unlucky. It's a great attempt.
Unlucky to just get one away. He was certainly in the target area. We've seen what sort of a player. He's not frightened to go for the shots. 4-0 up, though, after two ends to the
one shot,
American.
I saw when Ken first arrived, he was rolling up in the bowler's bar rink and he was using grooves.
4-0 after two ends.
So he's had quite a big change since then. Now he's to aces.
Yeah, we carry a pool of bowls here at the World Bowls Tour so that players can try different sets of bowls.
Yep.
I think certainly for yourselves travelling from overseas as well, you don't necessarily want to be bringing five or six sets with you, do you?
No, definitely not. Was tempted to bring a couple, but then never really knew what I'd be wanting to use over here anyway. Especially when we had to play on two different surfaces. So.
For those of you that are just tuning in, Dale and his brother Dean actually played in the overseas pairs playoff qualifiers, got through your group there and came out onto the portable rink here. It was a very good game. At least you've had the experience of one competitive game out there, Dale, which must be good.
Yeah, it was nice to get out there and get the experience. Unfortunately, I wish we had a bit more practice on it, but it is what it is, and had a bit of a struggle, but definitely learnt from it and look forward to coming back.
So this is all about playing every end of the set. So you have to play all seven ends of both sets. It's all about counting as many shots as you can. Two loose openers, both finished back to centre, but a bit loose.
Bit shorter length this end. interesting throw, considering he'd won the first three ends on a 27 and a 27 and a half metre length. Oh, sorry, the first two ends, I should say.
Yeah, not easy to get the jack length out there. It's not something we play at, particularly in practice. You tend to set a jack and play to it.
Yeah.
So you don't tend to practice sending a jack.
And four don't normally throw the jack in the wild pairs, do you? Or isn't it just spotted for you? Or it used to be?
Am I? It's no, you do still deliver the
jack. You deliver do deliver the jack?
Yeah. You hope you put it where your partner wants it.
I don't know what I've seen that in. I thought maybe it was a vent here, but maybe I'm wrong. It was a...
I think the difference is with the world pairs is we do have a marker out there. So as normally as a skip, if your lead sends the jack, you would center the jack.
One green.
As a skip. Yep. Whereas here, we Seven have one of our match time. Officials centers the jack, so they make sure it's absolutely perfectly centered.
I did get in trouble for that a couple of times. I went to spot it myself and... Yeah. got in trouble for it. I'll do it. Needs to get back.
It's under his own.
Perfect weight.
I'm holding. Yes, one green.
They almost look a bit like sunnies out there, don't they?
They do, yeah. Indeed. Your brother played with his sunglasses on his
on
hat.
His hand, yeah.
I did comment about this in commentary. I thought, well, you can't get more Australian than playing in your sunglasses. It wasn't quite snowing outside, but it was very cold that day.
Yeah, definitely. That's what happened when we were at the airport. We're still in thongs, yes, and shorts, and everyone just looking at us.
Dan's sporting shorts out there. It is very warm. Ooh. Out on the rink. We found a lot of players this year playing in shorts. He's under the line here. Oh.
He's
now, Ken moves. It
worse.
Might actually even be three here. Yeah.
Three. Oh, it's a bit of laughter.
Yeah, I didn't three just drink. Quite catch what Dan is a character. I'm sure he said something to the crowd there. The players aren't mic'd up in the singles games, whereas in the pairs they are. So you get the feedback of comments in the pairs. The spectators love.
Big chance here, draw this, get back to even. Considering most likely it was only going to look like one this end, and all of a sudden it could be four.
Running.
Three shots, Ken Chan.
Yeah, three shots. It certainly gets him back into this first set.
Set score.
Saying before,
four, three,
Dale, about how
three,
tough
yes.
it is to qualify. A lot of people aren't aware of the fact that you can have to play five or six games. Country, and then you've got to do the travelling as well, so
yeah.
it's tough getting here in the first place.
I think before we got on to this TV rink out here, we had played something like 13, 14 games. I don't know exactly, but that was just to get out here, and that was one round before the world stage,
meters.
Really, the main draw. So to come all the way from beginning in Queensland to then go on to Western Australia, to then be out here in the bowler's bar and then on the main green. So four different surfaces, a lot of games in between then.
Quite often find people sort of come up to you and say, oh, you better look next year, you've got the experience, and then they don't realise that you still have those 13 or 14 games to play
yeah.
again next year to get through.
Yeah, it's not so easy to just come back.
Good opener from Penn.
Great shot.
Brought the mat up, but he's played the jack to the tee.
The long length just doesn't feel that long, like it's only 29 metres, so like all outdoor bowls and or even other indoor bowls, like other than World Bowls Tour, it's all, what, 31 metres or roundabout. Well, throwing long, it didn't feel that long.
Well, that's when we play on the portable rink. Tee to tee is 29.5 metres. Say it's a lot shorter than a lot of our indoor rinks.
Couple of loose ones there. Dan would be hoping to sit off this bowl, get it in a nice position right behind the jack. I think he's speedy again.
One green.
About 2 feet behind is. Doesn't look too happy with it.
Your last bowl. The red, did you say? The last red bowl. It's just over 2.5 feet.
Can stick him with his forehand, even though there's bowls that sit on the backhand, but they are 2.5 feet behind. I feel like that's why he's asked.
Overplayed that, I think, like you say, Dale. I think he was just looking to just rest inside the red bowls.
Dan, too, very similar. See if you can adjust even a foot to get that turn back to the line. Even
it's decent.
Looks very good. Get down a bit. He's all over it.
Oh, he's just been unlucky. We've seen that a few times this week with the surface so quick.
Yes,
not green. Just sitting on a bowl, they're sort of going through the gap or just turning a little bit.
Turning sidewards through gaps. It's very difficult. Might be me, but Ken look a little bit nervous. I don't know.
Yeah, he seems to be a little bit nervous. I thought before he started the game he was prowling up and down the side of the rink before his practice session, and I just felt Dan did look a little bit more relaxed.
Yep.
But first time out on the portable.
Yep.
In this event, it's not easy. He might have settled in for two there.
Two. But come back here from Ken.
Two green.
Dan will really want this. Doesn't want to fall behind. After being 4-0 ahead, one bad result to drop that 3.
It's under a line with this. Needs got to reach. Hurry.
Not too bad of an effort.
Two shots, Ken Chan.
Ken Chan takes the lead, 5-4 after four ends. I'm just looking at Dan's overseas qualifier for the World Pairs from the USA in 2016, 18, 19 and 20. Qualified for the Scottish International Open in both 2018 and 19 and World Singles qualifier 2019 and 2020.
He's so done a lot of qualifying.
It's very, very consistent.
I think he got news this morning that he didn't get selected in the world team, which I hear is a bit disappointed. So he is hoping to go really well on this to sort of prove that he is good enough to be out there.
I didn't really get a chance much to talk to Dan before he went on to play. So, yeah, that's a bit of a disappointment just before you're about to play in a big game. You've got to try and put that behind you.
I think Dan needs the mat here. He needs to go back to that 27, 28 metres length where he was running the show a little bit out here. Ken's getting this first bowl right behind. A couple ends in a row now.
Good track. Reach the green bowl.
Dan.
Just under
Dan sticking with the one side of the rink.
Gap of 5 inches. It is Jack High.
Some Australian viewers tuning in from New South Wales and the Gold Coast, Dale.
Very nice.
Glad you can join us. That's the joy of this streaming. We go out all over the world. So many viewers. It's been absolutely fantastic. Great that you're joining us. What sort of time will it be out there? Or is that putting you on the spot to try and work that one out,
Dale? I think it was, before I started, I think it was like 7 something. It was, no, it'll be 8 at night. 8 at night in Queensland, 9 in New South Wales.
Right, so it's quite a reasonable time to be watching bowls.
Yeah, it's not
then.
Too bad. Not too bad.
I think before you played your pairs game, you told me it was about midnight at
so
home when
at
you went
PM.
On to play. Yeah.
Yep, it was midnight. Whole family was up watching. Great shot by Dan there.
One red.
Put me a bit more at ease. It's hard to get out of that, so Ken will be looking to play a big one here. Any touch on the jack should go to him.
So just hearing from the production team that we've got a lot of viewers in America. Not surprising with Dan out there. It's Florida, California area. I'm sure Neil Furman, a good friend of mine out there, who's now taken over organising the PBA in America. I'm sure he's tuning in as well. Hope you well,
on
Neil.
Your bowl, very, very small. It's a slight gap.
He's given us any tough questions so far, Dale. They're easing us into this day.
I see.
Fourth day here at the World Championships on the portable rink. Fifth day of bowls.
And the first day of the World Singles.
It is. Well, first game featured this afternoon.
Sure what Dan was trying there. I'm sure he was just trying to draw and put a little bit too much into it.
Be an interesting game at 2 o'clock this afternoon. Jamie Chesney, of course, he's played a couple of games in the pairs here. It's flamboyant players out on the portable rink in the top 16. Well, he faces young Chris Carswell, who came through a very strong qualifying group at the Falkirk Indoor Bowls Club in Scotland. And he's no stranger to these big events, so I don't think he'll be fazed by it. So
yep. And probably coming from the UK as well, he's had a lot of practice on these type of surfaces, so it won't be unnatural for him.
I don't think Jamie will get it all his own way, so join us, me and Dale, for 2 o'clock for that game. 2
get
o'clock UK time, I must say that, because we have so many viewers all over.
Good effort there by Dan.
One shot, down the LeMessurier.
Even match game. Back to 5-all. 2 ends to play.
This is a crucial end, I'd imagine.
Trying to get up before that last end.
And bearing in mind that it is a group situation, there'll be that little bit of nerves as well, because they know if they win a set, it gives them the point on the card.
Yeah. So it's not really the win of the game, is it? It's every set that you can get.
Every set matters.
It's major to get through this group. And Dan splitting his first game really does need this.
26 metres.
If Dan got a straight sets win here, we'd definitely be putting him in favourite in the group. But it's a long way off that.
Yeah, I see Richard Corrie sat in the auditorium, ready to go. He's the next game up. This morning, a short break between the two games, only about 10 minutes. He's playing against the Welsh young gun of Jack Breen. An interesting game on after this, folks. Stay with us if you can.
So both players using Taylor Aces, but Dan using a size 2. I don't know if too many people use size 2s out here, have you?
No, there are. Obviously, some of the ladies tend to play with a size 2. I myself play with a size 3 as well. But it's been funny over the years. It's been a question we often get about size of bowls. I mean, in the top 16 now, there is only really Mark Dawes that plays with a 5.
Oh.
So it used to be that most men played with 5s going back a few years, way before your time, of course.
Definitely.
But now I think predominantly men tend to play with a four. I know Mervyn King plays with a three. Mark Rawl plays with a three. So it's, you know, there's a mixture, but two is interesting. But we have had a question in from a viewer, Dale, and I know you'll be able to answer this for Australia, but they were saying, do the overseas qualifiers qualify on an indoor carpet or do they qualify outdoors? Now, just before you answer for Australia, I can tell you that both of these players that are out there now have qualified on outdoor carpets to come indoors. So both the Hong Kong and the American qualifiers are played outdoors. Is that correct?
So from what I know Dan qualifies on an outdoor synthetic. We're lucky enough to have some amazing facilities in Australia, especially where I am on the Gold Coast. We have Tweed Heads, one of the biggest clubs that I've ever been to, been around for a little while, being only 21, but been around to a fair few clubs, and Tweed Heads is one of the best facilities I've been to, and their indoor carpet's sensational, and that's where we play our PBA qualifiers. And from there, if you qualify through Queensland, you end up in WA playing at Mandurah on a beautiful blue carpet. We don't have many blue carpets, only in Western Australia. I don't know of any in Queensland, not that I know of anyway. And yeah, that was amazing as well, all fully covered. So yeah, it's the indoor atmosphere isn't new to us, but definitely the speed of these carpets are.
That was quite a good question from the viewers. Please bring in any questions like that. They're quite interesting because I think there's a lot of people that don't realise that some of these qualifiers, like these Rally qualifiers that are coming up next, they play outdoors.
Big shot there from Kenny. Really didn't want to drop a three there. It would have really jeopardised his set. Big one from Dan, maybe jack. Rest on Ken's last bowl if he happens to be a little bit quick. Inches. He sits it right through for the full count.
Yeah, I thought he might have just come up and had a look at that. There's no shot clock, so he can certainly come up to have a look. Just to know what the angle was, Dale, I think that might be quite important to picture it in your head before you play the shot. I mean, our match officials are absolutely, in my opinion, the best in the world. So they'll give you the best information they can. I just wondered if Dan had come up and looked at that, Dale, it might have made a difference.
Yeah, that's not the best shot I've seen Dan play. It was all for up there. He'd touch anything. It wasn't really going too bad. It was only if he was too quick, maybe he sliced his own, but the chances of that weren't that high.
Yeah, the other side to it is, Dan might say he didn't want to create a target.
It's true.
He's holding the one shot where he's placed his bowl. Possibly takes away the runner, certainly down the backhand.
I think he'd be wanting to run, would he?
No, I think if Ken played this down the forehand, he might remove his own bowl, which would be even worse for him.
You get around the jack, touch Dan's, you get your own out perfectly, you drop three and most likely lose a set from there. So I feel like he should be just drawing on the forehand, don't you?
Yeah, I do. He had a good look at that, though, and I think that's important as well, to just make your decision.
Where steadies his arm with his other hand.
Right, he's gone. I think that's what he was looking at, but it's very dangerous, is this?
Yes. Did he even
one
have
shot
the spot?
Down
maybe. One to Dan.
He had a good look at it. But, just think it was an interesting choice of shot.
6-5 after 6 ends.
One shot in it, last end of this first set. I love the question that's just come in, and I won't even ask Dale in advance if he minds me asking it, because I know what the answer is, but I'll let him answer.
All right.
We've had a question in from a viewer in Australia. Is there just indoor bowls and lawn bowls, or do you have
meters?
Crown green bowls?
No, we do not. No crown green bowls. Go to a park or a field, you can throw them around for a bit, but yeah, no, definitely not.
I thought that was an excellent question, because from my background, background's crown green, so I'm sure I'll just answer the viewer that if they had crown greens out in Australia, when I was in my heyday on the Crown Green. I'm sure I would have loved that if I'd have had to have been forced to go out to Australia to play.
Oh, forced, yes. Twist my arm.
Exactly. Crown Green is Dan. Predominantly through from Coventry up to Yorkshire.
I would love to see one. I'd love to see a Crown Green. I've never been to even an outdoor green here in the UK. Is there any nearby?
The closest Crown Green you're going to is probably over towards Coventry, Birmingham Way.
Right.
And then you're mainly up into Lancashire and over into Yorkshire. So if you qualify for something like the International Open that's played at Blackpool, that's obviously one of the hotbeds of Crown Green bowls. But there are some outdoor grass greens, certainly up into Great Yarmouth, Flat Green.
Right.
But not Crown Green.
So Great Yarmouth has an outdoor green?
They do. They run a summer festival there of bowls on the grass greens.
Maybe I'll go check it out before I leave.
Oh, good again here from Dan. This is not a bad start for
big starts from Dan.
The end of this first set.
Which one is the shot, please?
He would have really liked one of them on the line.
Bit of a target.
Yes, and you can see him back there shaking his head, so he's not happy with where they've been situated.
Oh, he's played the draw to rest the back red bowl. This is a tough shot because you tend to think to yourself, I need to reach that bowl, so just overreach it.
Probably quite handy there for his next two. He's got two more attempts. You know, he's already had a bit of a guide with that one. Depending on what Dan does, Dan will be trying to change it up. Play his shot first. Just touch a jack around the corner or even sit right behind it.
To get past the green one.
If he's here, he's not too bad.
Good ball again, Dan.
Oh, he's made it even bigger.
I don't think we'll see Ken being short at this.
No. That shot's still there if he was willing to play it, but do you risk, you know, losing the set because you're trying to play the perfect shot?
It's quite a big target. We've seen that he can play quite an accurate runner, so be in the area, ride your luck.
Hit it and then play one ball singles.
In the area.
Oh.
That was perfect result there. Stayed with it.
Great shot, an even better result.
Well, 2 foot to draw, possibly even a yard or
one
more
green.
To draw that. But
still a fair
2 feet short of the tee.
I would back Dan in here, although there is a bit of pressure on it. Oh, he's on the backhand.
Well, he could have stayed with the forehands, certainly enough room round the short bowls. Looks down a decent track. Now, what's pace like?
Needs to woo, I would think.
Good enough.
Great shot. Good enough.
One red.
You've just run, Janice. Do you try and sit that bowl through instead because you've just had a runner, or do you draw this?
I think it's possible that the short red bowls might be covering the direct runner at the bowl, which would be...
I think you're right.
Which would mean you'd have to play a timer down the forehands, and they're not easy to play.
Definitely not on this.
Still might fancy it. He's played a runner before when we weren't thinking he was likely to, and the bowl away, if he chopped onto the bowl and stayed as well, that would give him the 2 shots he needs.
I think I'd be trying to draw on the forehand if I was Kenan. Sit that bowl, try the jack instead.
He's going down the backhand.
The backhand, really, you've just got the draw, haven't you, unless you're tight.
Can't see him getting the 2 off the backhand unless he sits on Dan's bowl and pushes it out. That's, I think it was more off the forehand. He's only got 1 chance down here. Ties the set, though.
He's flying.
Yeah. I think that was the danger down that backhand.
Dan wins the set. It's always a bit of pressure relief getting that first set up.
He's just asking to see
one shot in the first set,
the situation up there, which is fair enough. You want to see where your ball finished. So the first set to Dan LeMessurier, the USA qualifier. We're now going to the second set. Don't forget, we don't have a tiebreak here. It's just two sets of seven ends. So that's one on the board for Dan.
Jack Lane, 24 and a half metres.
Questioning from a viewer, Dale, about the difference in the two rinks we play on. This is the portable World Bowls Tour rink, but your early rounds, you were on the bowlers bar rinks in Potters, near where the bar was. Handy for the bar, but they just wanted to know what the comparison was for pace, really, on the two rinks.
So we've played three games out there on the bowlers bar, and it was all running about 13 to 14 seconds, so it wasn't too quick at all. Turn-wise was... Well, for us, it was quite similar because we were using a little bit tighter bowls out there, somewhat more like home. Coming into here, yes, it does turn a lot more, but just the pace is 6 seconds difference. That was a big key for us. To simply answer the question, we have 6 seconds difference roughly. Quite a large difference in pace. But using such wide bowls, it doesn't feel like it's too much different with the swoop.
Yeah, certainly the bowler's bar rinks. I had a roll up on there before the portable rink was available, and they were running quite nicely. Nice pace, and the two rinks I had to practice on, all four hands were playing well. But this is a totally different thing, is the portable rink.
Yep.
It's hard to explain to somebody if you haven't been on it. I know when I very, very first qualified in the ladies, I asked a local player to meet who'd played a few times on it, where can I go to practice for it? And he said, you can't. And I've always stood by that, and I agreed with him that you can't practice anywhere else but the portable rink for the portable rink.
Yeah, I think at home the closest thing we've got is 2 hours from where I am. It's about 17 seconds and it turns a lot, and that's with tight bowls, so it's just a really swoopy carpet. So it turns a lot more than this, but this just looks like it turns more because everyone's using such wide bowls here, where we just don't do that at home. But yeah, that's still 3 seconds slower than this, so this is just a whole new league, elite class here.
Rest off his own.
Dan started well again. He's had a lot of time out here. I think he's really starting to pick it up. Don't know if he's ever had this much in previous years, this much time or this much practice on this green, but I know he's really determined this year. And to me, he's proven it. He's playing well.
Yes. We play a lot more now of the singles overseas on the portable.
Yeah.
For that reason, it gives them more of a practice, and the spectators like to see all the overseas players. It's a fantastic venue for that, is Potter's Resort. You get to rub shoulders with the players. I believe there's still a few day tickets available if you'd like to come on down. It's a fantastic venue. So they do get more time on the rink in the singles now. It would be nice if we could play every game out there on the portable, but we'd have to add another week on to the already 3 week event.
It does go for a long time, doesn't it? But it seems like the spectators love it the whole time. Stadium was almost full yesterday at one point. And it was only day, was that four?
Yes, because we start on the Thursday on the bowler's bar. It starts on the portable rink on the Friday. Of course, the setup starts the previous Sunday, so those of us that are organising and involved in that, it's our eighth day here.
Eighth day. Yes.
But no, it was a fantastic crowd yesterday, very appreciative. The roar when they clap is quite amazing when you're out there.
Yes, you hear everything out in the centre. All the oohs and ahs and the claps, the things you do want to hear, the things you don't want to hear.
They certainly tell you what they're thinking. They certainly tell you if they think that you've played the wrong bowl.
I put one in the side ditch and they loved it.
We've seen quite a few go in the side ditch.
Two shots,
down the
days.
Great start there. Two shots, second set. Don't forget, we don't have a tie break here. It's just
zero,
two sets of seven ends. Hopefully when we start the next game of the singles, we'll get a report in, I'm sure, from the deputy tournament director to let us know how the standing is in the round robin. Once they've got the calculators out and they've sorted it all out. Next game up, Richard Corrie, who is from New Zealand, but he's representing Canada in this event. And Jack Breen, who's from Wales, and he's the representative from the WIBC tournament. In that, he was actually beaten in the final by Stuart Anderson, but Stuart is already a member of the top 16. The runner-up gets to take the place, and that's how Jack Breen has managed to get into this event.
Yep. Very nice.
It's a bit similar in the ladies, because the WIBC winner in the ladies gets to come to the Ladies World Match Play, and that was won by Alison Merrion MBE, who beat Devon Cooper in the final. So Devon Cooper gets to represent the WIBC.
I see.
And as the draw comes out, Alison Merrion plays Devon Cooper in the first round. So well, that was interesting when that draw came out. There's eight. We qualify down to the quarterfinals, and the quarterfinals come out onto the portable rink.
I see. Very nice.
The ladies start arriving for next weekend. The mixed pairs starts on the Friday. Lots of games coming up over the course of the fortnight for you.
Couple of stray ones there from Dan to begin with. He started off the set well with a 2-0 lead, and then a couple of short ones. Can will be looking to execute here. We take advantage of a couple of short bowls. Maybe if Dan gets one in there, take it out. So, good chance for him here.
Two green.
Questioning from a viewer as to why we don't use a shot clock at this stage. Basically, because it's a round robin, it's a group stages, so they
4 feet past Jack Hart.
It's very, very similar to sort of the stages of the UK qualifiers and the Australian qualifiers, where you play off down to a final. And in the qualifiers, we do not play under the shot clock rules. I'm sure you don't, as you mentioned, you haven't played under shot clock,
yep.
Dale. So therefore, there's no. No shot clock in these qualifiers. The shot clock only comes into operation when the main last 32 draw takes place.
Three green.
I hope that answers your question, viewers. Any others? Just put them to us. Let us know where you're viewing from.
Dan really needs this. He strayed his first three bowls, too short, and then he's over-adjusted and gone quick. So Ken doesn't really have a great three, but it is still, well, two or three.
And it's always hard then, you put pressure on yourself with your last bowl, just like Dan's done here.
I'd be hoping to cut maybe the other one out. It's probably still two.
Still holding, it might only be two now, it's close for the third.
Dan, bit of a character, it sounds like he's got the crowd laughing again. He said something and the crowd giggled. Oh, and he's let that go a little bit. An easy draw shot there. Damn, with none to come. Be disappointed with that.
Definitely two. Not sure about the third.
Yeah, it was a free draw, really, there. I think two's been declared.
Measure
Umpire, please. Two green.
Umpire being called. Just while the umpire's being called, we have had a question in from a viewer about the match officials and do they have the right to ask people in the crowd to be quiet. Yes, they do. If there's a disturbance, there was a couple of disturbances yesterday in the pairs. Obviously, it's a packed crowd, so therefore you do tend to hear people murmuring and rattling sweet wrappers and those sort of things. But if there's undue noise when a player is on the mat, then you will find that the match official, normally the marker on the rink, but sometimes it's the umpire, they will mention to the crowd to please stay quiet. Also, if anybody's phone goes off, they'll tend to mention that. You're asked to turn your phone off when you come into the auditorium. But sometimes people just forget. Slapped wrist time if that happens. Two shots there to Ken Dale.
Yeah,
really Dan's got away with that, though.
Really loose too.
Dan could have been three or four down there. Did
yeah.
Bit of stretching there at the back of the rink, Dan.
Set score 2-3 after 2 eights.
He was saying he had a bit of a sore back on arrival, something like that. Ooh.
Oh dear.
And that one is gone. In my opinion, I think Dan should be trying to throw this 27 metre length. 27 to 28 metre length, that's really his goal. It's where he's going best at.
Yeah, Dan,
he's
as you
mentioned,
continuing
to throw short now.
Had this struggle with his back. Of course, he was a former professional, I'm probably going to pronounce this wrong, Muay Thai fighter. That's what he actually did for a living. And then he played basketball for Wales for 2 years when he was at university in Wales. So he's been very sporty over the years. And we all know when you get to our age, Dale, things start to creak and groan a little bit more than when you're 21.
I did see a video of Dan doing his, was it Muay Thai fighting or something?
Yes, quite amazing.
Saw his video when he was fit as, full six-pack and all. He always mentions he wishes he could go back.
But that's often where you pick up your competitive nature from, something in a previous sport. And that's an excellent opener from Ken Chan.
It's touching.
Notice this happens a fair bit when Dan seems to throw the jack. Ken really gets his first one going. Although I was wrong with the jack call, I did think Dan threw short, but he has thrown his length. Not a bad opener.
Still messing about with his arm there, is Dan. Works for Google now, does Dan. I think that's his sponsor on his shirt as well, Google.
Yeah, he's got a clothing sponsor of Nike, and he works for Google, who's sponsoring him to come here as well. He's got very different sponsors to what the rest of us have, like Bowls Brands.
Yeah, I mean, we're very fortunate, those of us that do have Bowls Brands sponsor us. In America, sport's very branded.
Who are you with, Janice?
Thank you for that question. I'm sure the guys at Drake's Pride will be very happy to hear me have to answer that question. Yeah, I'm a Drake's Pride, player. Drake's Pride are based in Liverpool, which is literally about 45 minutes down the road for me. So I'm quite happy with the brand, and I've been quite successful with them as well. So
Yes, definitely.
And I'm sat here in commentary dressed in Drake's Pride from top to toe as well. So.
Just really showing off the clothing and the brand then.
Because it's similar in Australia, you tend to get sponsored or supported by a bowls company.
Yeah, I'm lucky enough to be with Arrow. Kelvin Coco's bowl shop's very close to me, so everything's really handy, have access, thanks to Kelvin and Walter.
Elvin, one of the very popular top 16 players over here. That was just be a real crowd pleaser, did Kelvin?
Yes, he was giving me a few tips before coming over here. He recommended size 3s for him. He reckoned they worked well.
And that goes back to a question we had earlier about the size of bowls, doesn't it? It's quite interesting. Kelvin was one of the players that used to play with a size 3.
He's always used a size 4 back home, but he'd bring a size 3 here. He said something to do with the different temperatures and coming over here and having a bit of sweaty hands because of the air con in here and coming from our climate, the cold here, and then going into the indoor. And I noticed that myself when I was out there. I don't know if you noticed, I was always rubbing the hands together. I was nervous and sweaty palms.
A lot of players take a bowls cloth out there with them onto the portable.
So he seemed to think it was an Australian thing because we weren't used to the climate. I'm not sure about that, but I believe that, the size 3 must have worked for him.
Yeah.
Very successful.
Had a word for all the spectators. No, he's had a smile.
It was the same as yesterday, watching Dan's game. His first set was really good. The second set just dropped off that tiny little bit here. A couple of stray ends. A couple
needs
of loose
ease.
Short bowls. It's a freebie.
Two shots, Dan LeMessurier.
Another two.
Set score 4-3 after 3 ends. Chatland 23 metres.
Understand this. Dan's now gone back to short length.
Yeah, the early part of the first set, he was playing to the tee, like you say, 27, 28 metres, and was
going really well. Now he just keeps changing it up. Look, he's still ahead, but his first bowl's dropped a metre short. I don't know. I would have stuck with what's working.
No chance again now. It's gone through a yard. Ken looked a lot more nervous in the first set. He seems to have settled into it now as well, so. Ken plays again in tonight's game at 7:30 against Jack Breen. So these are all in a group stage, a round robin stage. The winner of the group goes through to play against Mark Royal in the main draw.
Decent weight if he gets right back to it. He's drawn the shot. The good shot by Ken.
On green.
How far short was I,
Dan? 18 inches from Jack High.
Needs to get back. Touch
overreach
quick.
That's the trouble when you've been short with two bowls, though. You just tend to think, well, I need to reach with this next one and just push through on it.
I was talking to Dan a couple of days ago. He was trying to tell me how to say his last name. Still have no idea. Tried 10 times and that was enough.
Gave me lessons the very first time he qualified because I was getting to the stage where I thought, I'll just say Dan.
Two green.
I often look at the draws as a commentator at the beginning of an event and think, now who do I have to find out how you pronounce the surname?
I asked him if I got it right, and he goes, yeah, you got Dan right, so we'll go with that.
I still don't think I get it right, but he says I'm close enough and he's happy with it, so I think, well, that's fine.
Yep. He's got a bit more of a bench to sit on there with Ken, drawing another shot right beside his first one.
Needs to run. Track's decent. I just don't think he's making the trip.
Possibly another free one here for Ken. See if he can execute on this. Played two good ones. Really not too much danger. Let's be wide.
Dan's gone off the side of the rink. It's probably, we sometimes say over here, go and have a word with yourself in the office. Calm the ship down.
Yeah, halfway through my game, I went a little bit behind the stands and tried to settle for a second.
Sip of water, just settle yourself, start again.
Away from the cameras just for a little bit.
Now, can this stop?
Another freebie gone by. Doesn't like his ad ones, Ken.
It's interesting here, though, in this second set, the
set score four,
counting
five,
the shots to each
four,
other's jack delivery, so it's like Matt's going back about a spot, up about a metre.
It's exactly where Dan puts it all the time, so are you saying we're throwing 28 metres?
Well, if he goes 28 metres,
right,
it'll be
Dan's
interesting
lane
to see what Dan does then.
He's struggling to judge a jack roll. Just kept going.
Jack length, 27 and a half metres.
He has thrown Dan's length.
Dan throws Ken's and Ken throws Dan's. And
Dan's doing lots of stretching at the back of the rink. Feels like he might have pulled something in that first set. Twisted badly. Not where you want to start carrying an injury. You can get through this game, you can always go off to the leisure facilities here, massages and whirlpools and hot tubs and all sorts of things that you can go and take the most advantage of this afternoon.
Haven't been to the spas and the pools yet, so I can check that out before I leave. I must say, what an amazing facility here. Has everything. Could never really be too bored around here.
There's always something to do. I went out to get a coffee before we started, and out on the bowlers bar rinks where you were playing the other day, it was absolutely packed. There was a fours competition going on, so there was eight players on every one of the six rinks, and you think, wow.
Very busy.
And there's a huge bowls shop facility here for the 3 weeks of the World Championships. Greg Harlow, who's the bowls ambassador here. Mark Royal, they're both around at the moment, I know, answering questions and stuff out on the shop area, so if you need anything and you want to pop down, that's the place to go. Full range of bowls about to have a look at.
What I did notice is they sell nothing tighter than like maybe a Defiance out there in the aero range. Everything's wide.
Well, in fairness, most of our rinks, certainly indoor rinks, are very slow at the moment.
Require the wide bowls.
So I normally play at home, my home club's Blackpool Newton Hall, and it's quite stiff there, and I play with the XP Drake's Pride model.
They're the widest ones?
They're the widest one. There is an XP Plus as well, but the XP is my bowl of choice for most venues I go to.
Yep.
Whereas here I'm playing with my fine lines, which are the tightest bowls I've got in the Drake's Pride range.
What do they measure up to? Are they a bit like a Revolution, maybe?
Yeah. Certainly similar to a Tiger Pro, Tiger 2-ish, to give me an idea on that idea. And we've had a question about the use of the portable rink instead of the rink that's actually under where you see the set now. There's a six rink international arena venue here. It's part of the World Bowls Tour branding. We play on a blue carpet and on a portable rink. The only place we don't do that is Blackpool Newton Hall for the International Open, where that is a blue carpet and we play on their bona fide rink too there. But it's part of the World Bowl. So we can go to a stadium that's a bowl stadium, or also we can go to just a sports hall and put in the portable rink. And yes, again, a question I was speaking to Dan LeMessurier about, they were saying that the overseas qualifiers, that's the thing you want to do, you want to get on the blue portable rink.
Yes, definitely.
That's the aim.
He's made that a little bit better there, outside half of the jack, put his bowl a little bit more centred behind the jack, a bit harder for Ken to get at.
It's the perfect draw, really. A lot of time on the mat. It would be interesting to see him perform under the shot clock. He's looking up at the crowd there, so normally means that player doesn't like the delivery. He's done decent track.
Get down a little bit and probably hurry some. I don't think Dan would be trying too hard here, I wouldn't imagine.
It's this one here.
Yeah. Holding one.
Yes, that one there.
I think he's just asking which bowl is second of the green, which one he has to beat. And don't forget, if you can stay with us directly after this game, we've got another game in the overseas group stages. Richard Corry representing Canada versus Jack Breen from Wales. And then set your timer, set your stop clock. The first of the main singles draw, 2 o'clock this afternoon. Jamie Chesney versus Chris Carswell.
Try to draw it on the forehand. Be awful wide here. He's not too far away. Maybe if he gets back down to the green. Oh, it's a great effort by Dan.
Just sat out.
A little bit risky if he had got his own there. He didn't want to half that jack to Ken.
Might just be the one.
And here we have it again. Dan's won Ken's length.
One red.
Well, he wants more than one.
Asking for more than one. Just think his last ball sat out, though, Dale. Yep. Just
one shot, Dan LeMessurier.
5-all, 2 ends to play.
Now the mat in the exact same spot, 1 metre up from the tee.
Let's
and let's see if
five
he
five
throws.
After 5 ends.
Will he throw his length? Will he throw 28 this time?
A lot of the viewers that tune in to me and the streaming will frequently say Janice always comes up with these patterns on. I'll say there's always a pattern on my card, and you're quite correct, Dale. They're winning to each other's jack.
Yeah.
And he's going. He needs to be going that 28 metres. He's gone further. Yeah.
Yeah. So he's thrown it this time. He's almost thrown it all the way this time.
And 28.5 metres.
28.5 metres. Yeah. Started superbly on this length of jack. Did Dan. Wants to finish this off, really wants to win the last 2 ends. If you can win the last 2 ends, that puts him in a great position in the group. But of course, Ken's got another game again tonight out there, so he would like to tie this game up with a set each, would be good for Ken. It's all close here, 5-all.
I'm just remembering just then, I believe Ken won straight sets in his first game against Boaz. I believe it was straight sets.
That was out on the bowler's bar rink.
Yeah, the very
it?
End
yeah.
rink. I just remembered then. I believe I was playing at the time. And yeah, so if Dan wins straight sets here, he'd be definitely leading the section. And the same goes the other way. If Ken wins this, he'd be leading the section by a set as well.
It's a bit of a loose bowl.
And there is 4 in the section.
That's 16 inches.
Yep.
Just Yeah, a bit early in the morning there. We were just doing a bit of counting on our fingers. Yet. There's actually five in the group, isn't there?
Yep, so the fifth one would be Israel. These two.
Next game's up is Richard Corry, Canada, and Jack Breen from Wales, and Boaz Marcus from Israel.
Yep.
I think Boaz is the one that's struggling at the moment in the group stage.
Yes, I believe he drew with Jack and lost 2-0 to... Oh, good shot. Both bowls. Yeah, lost 2-0 to Canada / New Zealand.
Shows he's not frightened to go for the big shots then.
No, definitely not. Cleared all that out. Two bowl singles now, really. Two versus one after that from Dan. A little bit disappointed, he's shaking that arm again.
It'll be interesting to find out afterwards, Dale, whichever one of us gets a chance to speak to him, if that's actually got a niggle there.
On green.
Had a question on the next year's qualifiers for the PBA. Of course, that all depends on which country you're from, but if you Google your local PBA branch, whether you're in Australia, New Zealand, Canada, America, Hong Kong or UK, Google your local branch and contact them. I'm sure they'll let you know. I think the questions come from a UK viewer, so I know the man to ask, Martin Gale. And I will ask him in the break, and I will confirm that to you in the next game. It will all appear on our website. That's a great bowl from Ken.
Three sensational shots in a row there from Ken. To clear Dan's two shot bowls out and then draw two himself. Dan maybe a little bit startled after he got both his bowls out. Ken took both Dan's bowls out and dropped a couple short, so... Big end from Dan here, needs a multiple. Nothing for a single, it all goes on set, so he really needs a set.
And again, it's the pretty pattern, so this is the end that Dan wins.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Even though he threw his own length that time, let's see what Ken does. You know, 27-ish. Nah, it's going all the way. Full length.
Jack length, 29 metres.
I've noticed with Ken settling his arm there, he sometimes uses more of his hand sometimes and less the next, so...
I wonder if it's his hand telling his arm how long he has to play the bowl. Maybe. I don't know.
Like, it's the whole hand...
I'm going to be sending you out from this commentary with a list of questions to ask these players, Dale. A crib sheet for the next time they're playing.
I'll be out for a couple of hours and I'll have 100 questions to ask, so...
Exactly. Oh, I always find it interesting, you probably have done as well now, having been in commentary. I know you've done some commentary in Australia as well, but I think it amplifies some of the mannerisms of some of the players as well, actually watching them in such close quarters, and it's always very interesting.
Yeah, definitely.
Body language in particular.
See everyone's aspects, see what they do differently, see what's good, see what's bad.
Try and learn from it.
Yes.
doesn't look too impressed, does he?
No, it looks like he could be in a bit of pain there. I'm not not sure. He's not got a lot of time before his next game either. He's the second game on this afternoon after the first round singles game of Jamie Chesney, Chris Carswell. So it'd be interesting to see Dale if he is carrying an injury now.
Yeah. He seems all right when he delivers. Like it. And nothing at the moment, so I'm not sure.
Now, needs to count really the two to tie the set at least, get half a point. I think this is running.
Still not bad.
One green.
Gives him a good chance to win the set.
How far is my ball behind?
It's about 12 inches past jack high.
Right, so the questions that we've got so far is Dan's carrying an injury. Are they sunglasses or are they glare glasses that Ken wears? I'm trying to think of my list of questions to send you with. Again,
he possibly have even made it better for Dan.
Yeah, there is the trail now. Play to the bowler Jack. Similar bowl to his last Dale, really, just slight adjustment.
Yep, don't change too much. Is he close? Needs to get down.
Needs to move. I think he's added a little bit of pace there.
It'd be interesting to see what Ken does here, because if that's two on the spot, you'd be wanting to get the spot on the forehand, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I think the shot's down the forehand. If he gets back to the red bowls, but be out there somewhere, break that three red up.
Get to the bowls, and if you are, do you get the spot? That's.
I think Dan's also got Jack straight back, hasn't he?
Yeah. Just anywhere out there, yeah. Can't cover everything. Maybe make him play the harder shot. The harder shot would be just trying to touch it, so. Interesting to see where this lands. Oh, Dan's got a great shot on here. He runs in the backhand inside half of that last landing bowl. You get maybe all three bowls out, you get half it through the jack, yeah.
Ken's shaking his head. I think he knows he's set up a bit more of a target.
All Dan's got to do is hit that front one, and most likely it's going to go good. Still a chance he can get the front one through his back ones and not get the result, but it's all backhand running, I believe.
He looks it. Everything behind his. I think if he went down the forehand, I think it would be a little bit silly because he's got the green ball to get wrecked on, whereas anything down that backhand.
Yep.
Connection with the bowl.
Loosen up, Dan. Might be the pain or I might be loosening the shoulder there. I don't know which.
Again, that's on your list of group questions to ask after the game.
I'm sure he'll tell me.
Now,
still good
go.
Shots there from Dan. It's not Dan, Ken. So.
There you go. Connection with the green bowl in the centre. Have you shot? We'll take the jack through to the back.
Firm weight.
Oh,
he looks under.
Can he get a result off the
front? Oh, nearly got a good result.
Nearly
too.
Did. Drop to two.
Drawn game.
Two shots in the second set. Ten shots.
Nice little comeback there.
That's one set each. Of course, we just play the two sets of seven ends. So one set each. One to Dan LeMessurier. One to Ken Chan. I'd like to thank Dale for his company this morning. I believe you're joining me again this afternoon, Dale.
Yep, I will be here.
Don't forget your crib sheet of questions you've got to ask these players. And don't forget, join us straight after this. Very shortly, we'll have Richard Corrie versus Jack Breen. Then, as I mentioned then, at 2 o'clock, Jamie Chesney versus Chris Carswell, the first of the first round games. Then straight after that, Dan LeMessurier will be back out there against the Israeli Boaz Marcus. And then tonight at 7:30, Ken Chan versus Jack Gray. Some great bowls all day for you. Really enjoy today's bowling, folks. Thanks for your company.